good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this important service today. Today we come to remember the life and to grieve the loss of our friend, our loved one, Marge Mead. I'm Jeff Pegler. I've introduced myself and reintroduced myself to most of you, but I was George and Marge's minister at the time of George's passing back in 2014, and I've remained connected to the family through Mark in particular over the ensuing years. But can I just remind you that we really today have come to connect with the sadness of our loss. Even though Marge has been with us for a lot of years, and in the last few years certainly hasn't been her old self, final is still final, and we must recognise that sadness is part of our loss today. But we've also come to remember her life and our time with her, and to commemorate that and to celebrate the good things that were part of that as well, as we think about that wonderful lady. But we've also come to support each other. A couple of people suggested it should have been down Melbourne, where most of you have come from, but even though you weren't all together coming up the road, just being together today is significant, isn't it? And I want you to pause for a moment and just think about your family members and friends who are here, and recognise that we're here for each other as well, not just here to celebrate and grieve the loss of a loved one. You might even like to continue that fellowship part of it and the support as we go for refreshments down at the RSL further down the main road straight after this service. So to Mark and Dennis and Adrian, and to your families and your friends and our friends gathered today, we want to extend our love, our care and our sympathy to you today. And as Marge would have me do, can I now lead you in a prayer of thanks for her life. Almighty God, we thank you for Marge Mead, for the lady you made as such a delightful, unique individual. We thank you for Marge's life, her faith, and her character and her connection with us. We ask that we may be able to embrace some of the qualities we've enjoyed about her and allow them to live on in our lives and through our beings and as part of our memories as well. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. As you'll see from your brochure, we come now to the life tributes. I like the idea that we don't necessarily always have to have a formal eulogy, you know, from birth date to death date and every little thing in between. I said at one funeral where I was conducting for a 94-year-old, even if we spent a minute for every year, there's an hour and a half for a start. So we're not going to tell all the stories today, but I think what people have chosen will take us all to special places in your life and in your connection with Marge, and allow those memories then to live on. So we're just going to hear from Dennis and Alex and Eliza, just one after the other, with their memories, their tributes on behalf of the families. And then we'll pause just for a second, and then we're going to have a photo tribute where you might like to gather all of those memories that have been made in words for you and just reflect in them as you see the photo tribute that Alex has put together. But Dennis, it's your turn. Come and share.
Yeah, well, here we are. 95 years, it's a long life. And as with many of us, even probably more so with Mum. Mum really was a product of her upbringing. She was born in 1927, and within 2 years of her birth, I think she went through the Great Depression. it's not an exaggeration to say that Mum came from very impoverished circumstances. She was the eldest of five siblings, and the siblings were born over 20 years. There was a 20-year gap between them all. All by the same father. We never met. I never met Mum's father. He was at best an itinerant worker, and probably at worst a totally absent father. And it meant that from Mum's birth, really, she was born into a family that struggled financially. Her mother did an amazing job to raise five girls, starting with the Great Depression. And Mum never really got over the upbringing that she had in those early years. She found that her mother was one of the original working mothers. I shouldn't say original, because I guess in the last century it was quite common. But Mum never ever took financial security for granted. Mum never had a credit card in her whole life. She never had a passport in her whole life. And it really shaped Mum's living, knowing what deprivation was really like. Having said that, though, Mum was born in the eastern suburbs in Sydney, loved Sydney, always thought Sydney was the place, even though the part of Sydney that she was born in, the eastern suburbs, in the 1920s and 30s was a very impoverished, dirty, rough place. And I can always remember as kids when we used to have to go and visit Grandma in the 50s and the 60s, we hated going to Paddington, absolutely hated it. It was just another world. We'd never seen anything like it. Yet Paddington now, of course, people think of it as a very salubrious address, very expensive address. I can guarantee you it wasn't like that in the 50s or 60s, and certainly not in the 20s. But Mum loved Sydney, always loved Sydney Harbour, always talked about the beaches. And I think the biggest memory that Mum had of her early life, and at 4 years of age, she actually was walked across the Harbour Bridge shortly after it was opened. And my brother Adrian has still got the certificate that was given to Mum and to all the people who walked across the Harbour Bridge in 32. And it was amazing. That was a memory she, despite all the deprivation and the impoverished life that she really had in being raised in Sydney, she loved Sydney much more than Melbourne. And then we found that because Mum born into an era of the Depression, her mother worked, which meant Mum spent a lot of time on her own. And just, of course, as the Depression ended, the Second World War started. So there was more hardship for the people of that era. And Mum found herself at the age of things that we wouldn't even consider doing now. Mum would always tell us stories about Mum would have to go off to work and she would be left looking after her younger siblings. So she'd be 12 years of age looking after a two-year-old and a one-year-old at home whilst her mother worked. Now, we wouldn't conceive of those things now, but they were relatively commonplace back in the 20s and the 30s, and certainly in Mum's life they were commonplace. So it's something to sit back and think about, a life that we just can't envisage here now. There was no single mother's pensions for a mother in those days. If a mother didn't work, no one ate. And Mum always remembered things like, for example, she always wanted her own home, and she got that eventually when she got married. But having to race from house to house to beat the rent collectors, things like that always had a great impact on Mum. And she was always frugal, to say the least, but she was always conscious of the fact that only take on what you financially can manage. Until the day she died at 95. Mum would still worry about how much money she had in the bank account when she really didn't need to think about those things, but it stayed with her all her life. And in some ways, it has stayed with some of us. We are all different personalities. I'm the more conservative one in the family, so everyone tells me. And they keep telling me I got that from my mother. Not frugal, no. But the other thing is too, of course, that we probably wouldn't have had the opportunity to have what we have today and we've been able to pass on to our kids if it hadn't been for what Mum and Dad did for us during what was hardship that we just never experienced, fortunately. I know, and Mum used to always say she wasn't the only person of that generation that had that upbringing. But it's something that people need to be reminded of these days when they don't understand what our forebears did and went through for us. And of course, Mum left school at 14. She was as much a carer, but not just to look after her young siblings, but to provide income so that the family could live. And I think in some ways, Mum always regretted the fact that she had to leave school so young, that she didn't have the opportunities that she felt that she could have benefited from, but she didn't. She then became a nurse, and that's where she met my dad. At the end of the war, Dad was involved in a motor accident and spent 12 months in hospital. And Mum was a nurse at the hospital. She met Dad. And the greatest thing, I think, in Mum's life, she was like, again, so many in that age, married at 20, pregnant at 21, and over the next 8 or 9 years had 4 kids. Now, we'd all say if our daughter was married at 20, even though my wife was married at 20, and her sisters were married at that age, we'd all say now, well, that's just, you know, cradle snatching. It's way too young to get married. But it was very common in those days. And so by the time Mum was 30, she had 4 young kids. She had, Dad always had residual issues with his leg after his motor accident. So from time to time, he needed care. So Mum's life up until certainly probably 40 years of age was as a perennial carer, not just for her siblings, but then her children and partly for her husband from time to time. And so that again meant that Mum perhaps didn't have the opportunities that many of you when our age and a younger age of kids have these days. But that made Mum a very insular person. She was never comfortable with people that she didn't know well. Familiarity with Mum was very important. She didn't make friends easily. Her friends, when Dad moved to Wollongong and we were all born in Wollongong, were basically people that she met where we lived in Wollongong. Mum's 4 closest friends all lived within 3 or 4 blocks of our house. And we had friends we called Uncle and Auntie. They weren't our uncles and aunties, but they were as close as Uncle and Aunties. And Mum's closest friend ever was my dad's sister, Auntie Jean, who's 2 of her children are here today. And Auntie Jean was just the biggest thing in Mum's life in the friendship era. So it's hard to imagine, again, this, you see it on shows like Neighbours, but in real life, our lives revolved around this block of 4 streets where most of Mum's friends were. Then, of course, in the late 60s, Dad moved from Wollongong. He was transferred with his job down to Melbourne. And Mark stayed in Sydney or Wollongong, but the rest of us all moved to Melbourne. And that was a huge, huge impact on Mum because she's, as I said, a very insular person. She moved from a nice, which in those days was a small place, Wollongong, not small anymore, but a small place to a huge place. We lived in the outer suburbs of Melbourne as it was then, North Baldwin, can you believe it? 8 kilometres from the city, and it was an outer suburb in those days. But again, Mum had to restart again, and she, being the insular person that she was, she left these 4 dear friends in, particularly Auntie Jean, who she missed for the rest of her life, and moved to Melbourne. Through the church, she met friends, but she was never comfortable in Melbourne. Melbourne was just too big for Mum, too impersonal for Mum. And so when Dad, at 60, Dad retired, and they moved down here. And she's been here for the last 42 years. And she loved Painesville, absolutely loved it. The number of times she told us it was the best decision she made in her life was to move to Painesville. And we'd say, what'd that mean? Away from your family, is that what you mean? She loved it down here. It was Mum's pace. It was small. Again, she had some very good friends from the church and social groups. And she felt, apart from the fact, I think she never got over Luke missing Auntie June. I think they spoke on the phone, you know, every second day. This was as happy as she's been, I think, since those days in Wollongong. And again, it was the fact that it was a more of a close-knit community, people that she could get to know well. And she always felt down here that life was way less stressful than it had been in Wollongong, and certainly for Mum had been for most of her life. So we're very grateful for the fact that people down here embraced Mum and embraced Dad. Dad loved it as well. In later years, we tried to get them to move back to Melbourne. It became obvious as they got older they'd need to be near their family more. But the problem is with Mum would never go back to Melbourne. It was evil. So she used to tell us it was evil. So she was never going back to Melbourne, but thankfully she did live here. And we're very lucky. All of Mum's grandkids had Mum for at least 30 years, which is a long time by today's standards. I had Mum for 70 years, and my brothers have had her for 74 and 67 or so years. So we've had Mum as part of our life for a long time, and that's something we should be thankful for. Our grandkids, my grandkids, I've got two grandkids that have been born in the last 2 years, and we certainly won't be part of their lives for as long as our grandparents were part of our kids' lives. That's something to be really treasured. It's something to remember, I think, too, with your grandkids. Mum had them for a long time. We won't have them for as long. So treasure them while you have got them, because it's amazing how quickly time flies. We didn't ever imagine that, Mum certainly never imagined that she'd live for 95 years. She used to tell stories about when her mother turned 50. She was the longest living sibling or female in their family. All of Mum's aunties had died in their 40s. Her mum died at 66, which is by today's standards very young. In those days was a good life. So things that we take for granted, Mum never took for granted. She could never have believed Dad would have lived to 93, she lived to 95. And that was, for her, just unheard of. And we're very grateful for the fact that it did actually happen. Mum was also a very deeply religious person, much more so than her children, unfortunately. But Mum always believed that when she passed away, she would go to a better place, and she'd be reunited with all those people that she'd lost. She's lost her husband, her daughter, her sister-in-law, and many other close friends. Her mum, all the rest of her family. She's already lost two of her siblings. Three still are alive. Our two brothers are still alive. So for Mum, I hope that what she believed is for her what actually happens, and that she does get the chance to be reunited with all those people that she so strongly believes she would have the opportunity to see again. So thanks, Mum, for everything you did for us. Rest in peace.
So driving down yesterday, Dad, Maggie and I were having a chat about Grandma, and I guess echoing everything Dennis said, you know, she had that great love for Sydney. Sydney and Wollongong was her home until she found Painesville. And she was very proud of her accomplishment of walking across the Harbour Bridge at 4.5. And as Dennis said, she proudly displayed that certificate in the living room at Villa Mead around everything else on those bloody walls. And now Adrian's got it to carry it through for the next generation. So Grandma was a nurse and she met the love of her life, Grandpa George, in 1946. Then they were married in 48 and then had Dad in October of the same year. And then it was followed by Dennis, Glenda and Adrian to complete their family. So Grandma, I guess reflecting on her, you walk into the house and you just sort of flooded with memories of growing up and... Grandma had a really strong passion for gardening, and you could always find her in the garden looking after her plants. Even towards the end, when she wasn't supposed to be going outside, Dad would turn his back for 5 minutes and she'd be gone, and you'd find her either up the side in the fernery or out the back trying to prune the orange tree in her early 90s. She was also a talented artist, so that wasn't something that I realised until recently. So the corridor heading down to Grandma and Grandpa's bedroom, it was all just full of her artworks on the walls. And she was also heavily involved in her church craft community, where she made a lot of really good friends and maintained her strong faith with the Uniting Church in Painesville. Grandma had an incredibly quick wit, and towards the end of her life, she could have this playful banter with the nurses at Maddox Gardens. And with Grandma, you didn't know if she was serious or not, and you could watch her say something and then wait for the response from the person that was a little bit shocked by what she had said. She also enjoyed doing her crosswords, and honestly, that woman was an absolute gun at doing a crossword. It was unbelievable, and her Sudoku as well. And she loved her murder mystery shows. She also had a really deep love for her family and was incredibly proud of all of us. And being able to watch her, I guess, with my own daughter and spending time with her at Easter is definitely something that I'll cherish for the rest of my life. So yeah, rest in peace, Grandma. Thank you for all the memories, and it'll be good that to know that you're reunited up there with Grandpa and Auntie Glenda and Auntie Jane and Uncle Dad.
Grandma, when I thought about sitting down and writing this speech, I thought it would be only sad. And whilst there is a lot of sadness, pleasingly I found myself smiling as a montage of memories started to flow. I thought about when you and Goppy came to Queensland with us. I thought about how you'd always refer to your pants as clown pants, how crosswords kept you sharp until the end, and how much you laughed the time Goppy went in the study to privately remove his false teeth to sort out a seed that had gotten stuck, not realising a young Georgie was in there, causing young Georgie to scream in terror. I will always think of you when I hear, "Don't worry, be happy," because of that singing fish that would belt out the lyrics when someone was at the door. And I'll take comfort that in the end, like when it got to 9 p.m. at your 90th birthday party, that many people had travelled far in order to attend, you knew you were ready to go. 95 years and almost 34 together. I'll miss you and love you always.
Thank you, Dennis and Alex and Eliza, for those personal memories, but they're more than that, aren't they? Because they've taken each one of us to those places as well, and it's been interesting for me to see that person through your eyes. So thank you for helping us do that today. So stay in those memories as now we look at a visual tribute, and maybe these photos will help pull the rest of your story today together.
For you and for me. calling, calling, oh sinner, come
jelly notes at the moment. That was powerful. Not just that, what was said about Mum, it's just, as Mum would hate me saying, I was gobsmacked. It was just beautiful. Yeah, thanks Dennis, I really appreciate it. And Eliza and Alex, of course. But to have your own brother get up there and say all that was, it's almost more than I can bear. Anyway, we're reading from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this was not so, I would have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you. When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am. And you know the way to where I am going. No, we don't know, Lord, Thomas said. We have no idea where you are going. So how do we know the way? Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one come to the Father except through me.
Thanks, Mark. I think it would be remiss of me as a friend of Mark's over the years to not just acknowledge your care that you've given to Mum over these last years as well. You've done a lot, and I know you've sometimes put up with a bit as well in those years. So I just want to acknowledge your part in this process as well. And Maddox Gardens as well. I've just heard so many family members just pay tribute to the care that Marge received there. That wasn't on the script, but anyway, I thought it was important for us to actually acknowledge those things. I want us just to think together just for a few minutes about Marge's faith, but in particular about grief and how we travel through, well, this grief in particular. I'm not actually a cricket tragic. In fact, if you want the truth, I've never actually played a formal game of cricket in my life, but I do like watching some sports and cricket when it's on and interesting. And I actually have watched a little bit of the first West Indies-Australia test recently, the Perth test, and I could not help but be impressed with Australia's opening batsman this evening, Marcus Labuschagne, who made the 200 in the first innings and then 100 plus a few more in the second innings. His celebration after the 200 was absolutely enthusiastic, but I thought really fitting for that moment. And then again for the next 100 as well. But when I saw him celebrate and lift, I think, his helmet and then his bats to his teammates in the stand and then acknowledge the 6,000 or however many people were around, I was immediately taken back, actually coincidentally, to 2014, the year George died. Not because of that, but because of a different celebration that almost seemed to occur from that year onwards when cricketers made significant number of runs in that. It was after the death of Philip Hughes, the cricketer who was hit in the head with a ball back then. And after that, whenever it seemed a batsman made a significant number of runs, they wouldn't actually just acknowledge their teammates in the stand and the other people around them, but they would lift their bat after touching their black armband and lift their bat into the sky. as if to say, yes, Phil, I know you're watching me. Yes, Philip, you helped me through this 100, or stop me getting out then, or whatever they were thinking in their minds. And it has continued on, hasn't it? People who have acknowledged Shane Warne's passing as they've achieved something on the cricket field. It made me think that we all find comfort in a belief that our loved ones, even though they may have physically passed from our presence, still live on in more than just our memories, live on in ways that maybe oversee us, maybe not oversee us too much though, or too tightly, but oversee us or still have some sort of an interest in us. Beyond their earthly existence, they still have that connection with us. And our Bible reading today that Mark read takes this from a slightly different perspective, where Jesus said, don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. And Jesus was saying these words to his disciples as he was preparing to leave them, and he was trying to prepare them for staying here as he returned to his Father in heaven. Don't be troubled or worried. You have a heavenly home that I'm going to prepare for you. It's going to be with me, and I'm going to come and invite you to that heavenly home, he was saying. I remember chatting with Mark over the last decade, actually, because it goes back to before George's death, when they were considering the need of having to place Mum somewhere. Firstly, it was in the Painesville Nursing Home for respite, I think, for a little while. And then, of course, later on, when she became a permanent placement in Maddox Gardens. How can we do this? Taking her from her Painesville home, and as we've just heard, Painesville was the ultimate home because it was better than Melbourne anyhow, Dennis. But how can we do that? But you know, friends, when we put it in the perspective of where Marge believes she is now, and in the perspective of eternity, a little time in a nursing home seems such a short time, doesn't it, compared to eternal existence. Marge was and is confident of her eternal home, of being in the presence of her Saviour, and of being united with George, as a few of you have already alluded to. And friends, while we can take solace in the news and comfort from the knowledge that Marge is free from her suffering and from the other impediments and the limits of ageing, we still are faced with the reality of having to say farewell, of having to say goodbye to a loved one here on earth. So while we might believe that she might be able to oversee us or look down on us or whatever you believe in that space, we still have to deal with her physical departure from us. And Jesus actually had some words of comfort for the disciples when he knew he was going from them. He also said, not only am I going to prepare a place for you, but I'm going to leave my peace with you, my presence with you, so that you will remember me in this earthly existence as well. Peace I give to you, my peace I leave with you. So that's the other half of the beauty of faith, is not only do we know about a heavenly home, but we have a loving Saviour who walks with us even through the darkest of valleys of life as well. So just in concluding, grief is a powerful and a real emotion, isn't it? It lets us know how much somebody has meant to us, and you've all expressed that already today. It's a measure of our connection with them, if you like. But it's also a pathway of disconnection from their physical presence with us. I often quote a little phrase that I find really meaningful about grief at funeral services. It came from a silly dictionary, but it's actually a profound statement. It says this: grief, love left over at the end. For Marge, I'm sure that it is not the end, but just the transition to her continued life with God. That's the wonder of Christian faith. Life with Jesus here continues with him as he takes us to a place he has prepared. But what about us? What are we doing with that love left over at the end? I just want to leave you with just one practical a couple of practical suggestions that we can actually exercise in acknowledging our grief and actually making that grief into a healthy emotion. Here are just a couple of suggestions. They might work for you. You might not even need these. But firstly, share the memories and the influences of that life. You know, that enlivens that person too, doesn't it? But sharing it with somebody else actually makes a difference as well. Don't forget to enjoy the support of each other as you grieve together. And make sure you do that over the time of refreshment as well. And recognise that grief comes in all shapes, forms, expressions and time frames. I've said to a number of people, grief caught up with me in its deepest form 4 years after my dad died. And I was in his shed trying to find something in the conglomeration of other things that were in people who grew up through the Depression's shed. And I remember catching myself as I turned around to say to my wife, Pam, go in and ask Dad where the saw or wherever it would be. But I didn't get the rest of the sentence out because in the middle of it, I realised Dad hadn't been physically around for 4 years. But his memory lived on to the stage where it encouraged me to actually even almost ask that question. So time is sometimes a trap in grief, but sometimes it actually enables us to relive some of the good memories of and experiences of somebody whom we have loved as well. So share, enjoy, recognise and allow faith to inform you of God's secure eternal destiny as well. I really trust today that already you've been able to find comfort in your grief, especially as you explore the various pathways your grief leads you from this place of loss onto the rest of your life. One of the other helpful ways I have found in conducting these services of people attaching to their grief and even saying their final goodbyes is to have some tangible act of goodbye. We do it at grave sites by putting castings in the grave, but what we've decided to do today because of Marge's love of roses is that we're going to offer you to come and place some petals and float them in the bowl of water there, just to consolidate your memories. But if you want to pause and say your final goodbye to Marge at that space as well. This is an offer. If you're just more comfortable sitting where you are, that's fine. But if you'd like to come forward and take some petals and float them in that bowl, then feel free to do that. And then just return quietly to your seats. There's no time pressure on this. Just if you feel that that will be helpful for you today. I'm going to suggest that family, close family be first, and then after that you're going to have to work it out all by yourselves. I'm not going to number you off or anything like that, but just let's give each other time to just pause in these moments as we do that. Anyone else wants to come forward, feel free to do so. Going to ask you to stand as we come to the end of this service. Just going to offer a prayer of comfort and then just a couple of verses of scripture just to actually be part of our final goodbyes and committal of Marge. Almighty God, we come to you in need of comfort and of your loving care. We thank you for Marge's life, but we also declare our deep sorrow at losing a family member and a friend. Lord Jesus, as we celebrate this life today, may we know the comfort of your peace and the assurance that you have welcomed with loving arms our friend, our loved one, into your eternal, secure presence. Loving God, we bring this family to you now. May they know the comfort of your love and the assurance of your peace. We thank you for your constant presence, reassuring grace and marvellous mercy. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Friends, as Marge would be able to tell you, Jesus himself made some clear statements about his intention to welcome people into his loving presence. Jesus himself said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though they were dead, yet shall they live. The psalmist said, the Lord is faithful to all his promises and loving to all he has made. The Lord upholds all who fall down and lifts up those who are bowed down. And just one verse from Deuteronomy, just as a blessing as we go today, and you can just move out when you want to, and don't forget the RSL is down the road for lunch. We're actually going to put the visual display on immediately after this final blessing, in case you missed a couple of those important slides on the way through. So you can either just take another seat at that stage, or just chat together, whatever you choose to do immediately after the service. Remember, the eternal God is your refuge, and underneath are his everlasting arms. Amen. May God bless you and be with you. All right.
Yeah. It is. Look, I remember it was your